Hello, I'm Linda Dunn, coming to you from the LG Digital Studio at Georgetown University School of Continuing Studies. I'm the faculty director and assistant professor of the practice for the Master's in Supply Chain Management program. In focus today, the impact of AI on supply chains. I'm joined today by Jackie Barbieri, who is both the founder and CEO of an AI-based company called Whitespace. She is also an alum of Georgetown and a TEDx speaker. Welcome, Jackie.
Thank you, Linda.
I have a couple questions I'd like to talk about this subject. And really, first, before diving into what Whitespace uses with artificial intelligence or AI, could you just briefly describe what AI is to those who might be confused as to what it encompasses?
Yeah, this is a really good question to sort of start it with as a scene setter. And I think for a lot of practitioners in the space, in particular, the definition is shifting every day as advances come along. But I think it's really helpful to think about AI in two parts. One is the verb and one is the noun. The verb is machine learning. Machine learning is really an extension of statistics that's used to find patterns and features in large data sets. And so that learning is what allows a model, an AI model, which is the noun, to look at new data that it's never seen before to detect those things. So that's one way, one type of AI, and one way to understand it is the verb and the noun.
I think that's helpful to see it like that, really. You know, Whitespace uses crowdsourced location data to predict risk. Can you share what that means? How is AI involved in what you do?
So AI is involved, it's primarily the verb part, machine learning. So we leverage commercially available data sources about how things and people move around in an environment. Mm-hmm. And so we understand aggregate activity patterns over time. When we see a change in those activity patterns or a change from what is normal, which of course is learned over time using mm-hmm. machine learning techniques, that's how we know to trigger some sort of an alert or to look deeper at what's going on.
So it's really the change or the anomaly that happens that becomes, you know, the risk or the thing you might look deeper into.
That's right. Whether it's from a compliance standpoint or in the case of live event security, we see a crowd density surging in a certain area of a venue. And that's a situation where you might want to throw an alert, right? It's a real-time physical risk. When it comes to supply chain, however, you know, there's a step before alerting. There's a step before the risk spotting, which is being able to map first and do the mm-hmm. discovery of what are all of the components or nodes in that network, or maybe network of networks. So that discovery and mapping piece is really critical. And then there's a period of time where we study or learn the normal behaviors within that network. So what are the activities that are normal for this specific subset or network of tier two suppliers in a supply chain, for example? And then at that point, once we've understood what is quote unquote normal,
right.
Then we can start watching for risk and doing risk spotting.
Interesting. So it might be time of day patterns or mm-hmm. amount of people patterns or traffic, I should say.
Definitely. And everything from a natural disaster that was unexpected or an unusual weather event to just normal, I won't say normal, but delays that can cascade from upstream in a supply chain, downstream. All of those things, changes in activity are things that we can track and detect at a pretty granular scale.
That's fascinating. You know, what type of risks, you've talked about some of them with surging and things like that, but particularly supply chain related, do you think this can mitigate this type of technology?
So one use case we're looking at very closely right now is actually sustainability and climate related.
Wow.
So there's some proposed SEC regulation that would right. require registrants to report on the greenhouse gas emissions both upstream and downstream of their operations.
Yes.
That's a big ask. And there's a whole host of unknowns involved in that. So that first step I talked about of mapping and discovery turns out to be quite a powerful capability for companies that can't see beyond tier one. Right, so this isn't a risk per se, but understanding your organization's footprint in climate, in, when it comes to climate change, is incredibly important and increasingly so, both in the United States and in Europe. So that's one example of maybe a longer term risk that we're helping companies spot.
Yeah, no, that's a great example. It's a huge focus right now by many, many companies, and we know supply chains are the main portion of greenhouse gas emissions, right?
Yep.
So let me ask you this too. There's a debate, it's bigger than ever now, about sort of the ethical nature of AI. Some aspects such as bias or breach of privacy, you know, lots of different issues right now. How do companies in this space, which is really an emerging space like your company, balance these amazing capabilities with these ethical questions that are out there?
I think it really comes down to the company, its culture, and its leadership. At the end of the day, there is no rule book out there that I can go pull off the shelf and say, okay, these are the rules I need to follow to get an ethical stamp of approval, right? We're writing the book as we're developing these technologies. And not only developing them, but then applying them in an operational context, right? I think it's really important for companies to keep in mind some privacy considerations specific to information about how and where things move and people move. It's a special class of information. It's not so much like documentation or PII that I think most folks are aware of. But our company has taken this very seriously in terms of ensuring that we adhere as closely as we can to all standards of what's called differential privacy. So there are some ideas out there about how you maintain privacy when you're looking at individual things moving around in an environment. But implementing those, they're called privacy-enhancing techniques, or PETs, at scale, that has to be part of your technology roadmap, right? So that's the privacy side of it. For example, one rule we have at Whitespace is we're never going to reveal the specific location of any individual person or thing in the course of our work, no matter where it is, even in a public space, right?
Right.
Unless there's some, you know, legal requirement that we do so, right? Some legitimate requirement that we do so. So every company needs to set their own line in the sand, so to speak, and not cross it. And the more that can be implemented in their tech stack, the more confidence they can have that they're not going to run afoul of whatever that line is that they've drawn. Now, on the ethics side of it, and when it comes to ethics and bias, this is, I think, a much bigger topic. Probably require a series of videos to work through.
I realize that.
But I think it's a great question, because most people, I think, are aware of the biases that can be introduced just by the training data you expose a model to.
Yes, exactly.
But also, as we're seeing with more generative AI techniques that I think most people are playing around with these days, that there are emergent biases that can result from these technologies. And it's going to get harder and harder. When it's something being emergent means that it wasn't planned, right? It wasn't designed for. It just occurred. And so avoiding these types of crossing of an ethical line or inherent biases that are emergent properties of a generative system is a really hard problem.
Yeah, I think it's one we're going to have to look very hard at in the coming year, not even years.
Agree. So. I feel like I'm behind the curve already, actually.
But it's good to hear there are protocols, fascinating, and more to come. Your company does some great work with really mitigating some risks for the supply chain and adding value. So thank you for joining us today and sharing your insights. It's really been a pleasure talking with you. And stay tuned for everyone out there. Thank you for watching, and there's be more from Georgetown SCS Digital Studios.